Welcome to Motherbird Blog.
The Labour Story of Lucy Grace. It's like deja vu. I'm back here again to update you all on how my mini beast got out of my baby chute with no details being held back. Tuesday the 7th of February 2017. Little did I know this is where it would all begin. At 9:15 a.m. I had a consultant appointment at Johnson Hospital in which I was 39 plus 4 weeks pregnant. As always, the consultants came striding in 20 minutes late, swanning through the doors to a room full of heavily pregnant women who were sat throwing them daggers because nobody likes an unpunctual, unapologetic asshole. Not that I was holding a grudge or anything for them making me wait. Tom had Ruby and was in the car waiting as she was poorly and asleep, so time wasn't something that I wanted to be wasting. With Ruby being ill, it was only a matter of time before she'd wake up and lose her shit, and I'd be bombarded with messages from Tom asking how to defuse the grouchy grenade. The daggers must have worked because shortly after I was called into a room and began listening to the doctor. He was talking, but I had absolutely no clue what he was saying. He had a strong accent and I found myself sat there nodding like a dog. Between nodding cluelessly in agreement to everything and asking pardon after every question, he must have thought I was the most idiotic pregnant woman ever, as I sat opposite him with my cankles out and the chair shivering beneath me. Out of all of the drafts of the conversation I understood, it was agreed that the midwife would come give me an internal to see if my cervix was favourable. If so, they'd then give me a sweep today and plan an induction date, and if not, they'd see me again next week to offer another sweep if my cervix was more favourable. Thomas and I had been practicing the cervix softener special most evenings, so I was hoping that my body was starting to naturally prepare for labour. His super sperm had worked to produce two babies, so I was hoping the little soldiers would power on and not let me down and start to soften my cervix. Once again, I found myself with my pants on the floor alongside my dignity, the midwife diving between my legs to see what discoveries would be made. The midwife happily announced that my cervix was soft, Tom's soldiers should get Olympic gold medals, and that I was 3 centimetres dilated. Little lady wasn't engaged, but she wasn't far off, with a big bag of waters bulging by her head. Within a few seconds, she'd done a sweep, which was only slightly uncomfortable. I'd previously read on Google some ladies' experiences, some of them described it as scenes from a horror movie. Luckily, in my experience, it was over quickly with minimal discomfort, so I was good to go. They'd booked me in to be induced on Monday the 13th of February in case the sweep didn't kickstart anything on its own. And off I was left to waddle back to the car, now feeling even more like a ticking time bomb, knowing I was 3 centimetres dilated. Later on that evening, just before bed, I was in a hormonal hag sort of mood. After the sweep, I hadn't felt anything all day long, not a twinge or a single thing. I knew they'd explained it doesn't work for everyone, but I still couldn't help but feel really pissed off that it hadn't even brought on Braxton Hicks. It had been roughly 12 hours since my sweep, with nothing, no signs of anything changing soon. What a load of bollocks. Wednesday the 8th of February 2017, 3 a.m. Out of the blue, I woke up with cramp-like period-type pains. Completely bearable, just uncomfortable cramps that was coming every 5 minutes and lasting 40 seconds roughly each time. Immediately, I woke up Tom and told him I was cramping, hoping he'd know what to do or say in this situation. Or so I bloody thought. The response I got was not quite the one I had envisioned. Tom grunted, okay, and rolled over and went back to sleep. Ah, it looked like I was going to have to consult Google, so I found myself searching difference between Braxton Hicks and labour, and when to know when to go to hospital in labour. Since last time I was induced with Ruby, I was clueless as to how to tell if this was the real thing or not. All I could do was time the contractions and see if they built up or not. At 3:38 a.m. I rang the midwife for advice about when I should go in. The pain was increasing and the contractions weren't going anywhere anytime soon. She said to wait until they were 3 minutes apart and take my breath away. She then went on to say to take some paracetamols and get some sleep. Sleep? Easier said than done when every 4 minutes your womb decides to spasm and have a late night rave. Sleep was out the window, and after taking the paracetamol, most patients were starting to leap out the window too. Our bloody kitten kept striding on up to me and headbutting me or pawing at me mid-contractions for attention, whilst I had Tom snoring cheering me on in the background. What a supportive birthing partner. By 5, the pains were intensifying again, but still 4 minutes apart. The paracetamol hadn't done anything, and I'd been just sat in bed and running to shit every 5 minutes between contractions. If this was the real thing, I was going to try and maintain the no shitting myself streak. So I decided to run a warm bath to try help pass time and see if it helped ease the pain. It seemed a brilliant idea until I was laid in the warm water with my gut protruding out of the water whilst having a contraction. I must have looked like a whale trying to fit in a fishbowl. The water wasn't covering my bump, so wasn't providing any relief at all. So there I was, ferociously during contractions, using Ruby's hair jug to try pour water over my stomach whilst trying to roll from side to side like a pig in shit. If this wasn't relaxing enough, the kitten had decided to join in on the fun and games. Whilst I'm there rolling around, the kitten begins to start jumping up at the light switch cord, playfully making a racket. Just hopping out of the bath wasn't going to be an option. I was going to need a forklift, so I had to call Tom, asking him to grab the cat, as I was scared the noise was going to wake Ruby. Tom stomped down the corridor, the diva he is, marched into the bathroom, threw me the dirtiest of looks, grabbed the cat and trundled back off to his pit to go back to sleep. How dare I disturb his beauty sleep? 6:05 came, and it was when I rang the midwife again. My contractions were now roughly 3.5 minutes apart, lasting 45 seconds. She said it was time for us to come in and get checked out. It was time to wake Tom up. I called my mum and she said she'd be on her way to look after Ruby, who, just like her father, was still asleep and blissfully unaware. Once Tom was awake, it took a while, and out of bed, he decided to drop into conversation that he needed to pop to the shop on the way there for fags. Was he actually joking? Luckily for Tom, my back was turned from him when he asked this, because I swear my hair turned into flames and I momentarily lost my shit, ready to explode. Thank God I had another contraction seconds after his stupid suggestion that took my breath away before I could bite his head off. One thing I was definitely not missing out on was breakfast, so whilst Tom nipped outside for a quick fag, I dived into the cupboard and found myself shoveling 2 Weetabix down my throat like the hungry hippo I am. A girl's got to get her energy from somewhere. At 6:22, I went to the toilet and rang Tom, who was still outside. I'd had blood mixed in with discharge and wanted to show him as I was concerned. He came rushing in and reassured me it must just be what they call the show, but to mention it to the midwife when we get to the hospital. Whilst I attempted to pull my granny pants up my fat thighs and get off my porcelain throne, the cat kept rubbing itself up my legs and wouldn't get out the bloody way. 6:31, I rang my mum because she still wasn't here. She reassured me she was a few minutes away. So there I was, bouncing on the exercise ball in my living room, my blue starry fleecy pyjamas, waiting for my mum. Whenever I had a contraction, I'd go quiet and focus on my breathing, whilst Tom would rub my back in circles. Minutes later, Mum arrived as promised. With my next contraction, I was bent onto the sofa trying to breathe through them. Mum decided to help by rubbing my back for Tom, but what she didn't realise was a scarf was dangling down in my face and tickling me, which, as you can imagine, resulted in me snapping to get your scarf out of my face. I've never been the kindest person when in pain. Within the next contractions, I was putting my shoes on with help from Tom, and the cat decided to come entice himself around my legs once again. Just why wouldn't it get lost? I saw red, and the cat saw stars as it flew in circles across the living room. Tom and my mum exchanged glances, and Tom said, "Are you sure you don't want to go instead?" Whoops, maybe it already lost my sanity. 7 o'clock. We had arrived at hospital. We was then put in labour room 2. The midwife Jo sat us in there and we were told they'd see us shortly. They then came back and asked if we'd swap rooms with another lady as she was needing the room ASAP. So I waddled to the day room with Tom in tow. 20 minutes later she came back in saying the other lady had already given birth before they could move her. So off back to the room we went. Between 8 and 9 whilst waiting for Jo to come give me an internal and an exercise ball, we heard the most horrific sounds ever. A lady further along the corridor was screaming for the life of her like a banshee. It resulted in Tom and I exchanging looks of panic. Where was the opt-out button? I was not ready to go through what she was going through. Again she screamed, "God, oh God," which left us questioning whether she was religious or not.
My contractions had slowed back down and were now coming every 5 to 6 minutes. By 11:30, it was time for an internal. Poor Joe had been running around like a headless chicken and finally got time to do one. I was calm and relaxed, managing my contractions well, so there was no urgency. I was mentally preparing myself for the news that I was still 3 centimetres dilated and that they were going to send me home to come back in when the contractions were more regular. While she was gearing up to go in my lady garden, she asked how far away we lived. When we said Spalding, she retorted with, "Oh, at least it's not too far away then." Brilliant. She's nearly certain we were going to be sent home too. Jo popped on her gloves and in the baby chute she dived. She spent much longer than usual diving into my fetus factory, which made Tom and I exchange looks. What was the matter? Her face seemed puzzled. Finally, she removed herself from me and said, "You're not going anywhere. You're 6 centimetres dilated. The baby's not engaged and the water's there bulging. So if your waters don't break by 3:30, we will break them for you to help things along." 6 centimetres. At 12 o'clock, Jo came in a little while later and explained how she was running the ward. She couldn't offer me one-to-one care, so was going to pass us to another midwife. The midwife suggested that we try aromatherapy oils to try and make my contractions more regular. So she brought in some weird smelling oils. This was for Tom to rub in my lower back and stomach. Once rubbed in, Tom made a huge song and dance about how he didn't like the feeling of it on his hands. Sometimes I have to be reminded that I'm the one with the vagina in the relationship. She also brought in some lights that changed colour gradually and some music. Tom and I was all set for our own little party. We then went for a walk around the hospital and nipped to the shop. This is when I got treated to a pack of plain biscuits that I could enjoy during labour. Talking about treating myself and going all out. Upon returning back to our room, I'd had a bleed from where she'd had a good route around during the internal. Next time she can borrow the sat nav so she doesn't get lost in my cave again. So I got changed into a gown so I was all nice and clean again. 1 p.m. Between contractions, we'd been talking happily, but whenever I'd have a contraction, I'd zone out and bounce on the birthing ball whilst Tom rubbed my back. He was being fantastic. At my beck and call, passed me water and meeting all my stressful demands. He'd decided to make a start on the bag of snacks I'd packed in his hospital bag. For my next contraction, I stopped bouncing on the ball and muttered Tom's name, which was his cue to start rubbing my back. This time round, he also thought it was his cue to cram a jammy dodger into his pudding chute and sit chomping away in my ear. With specks of spit and crumbs flying onto my face, if this wasn't bad enough, he decided to declare to me, "I'm eating a jammy dodger." No fucking shit, Tom. I wouldn't have guessed. Oh, and Tom's munchathon didn't end there. Next few contractions, he thought it was appropriate to graze on a bag of Skittles like a camel. It was like having a washing machine in my ear. Totally not the hypnobirthing noises I'd previously tried listening to. And finally, the grotesque swamp donkey decided that he wanted to go the whole hog and eat a pepperami. You know, just one of the smelliest foods going. I was mid-contraction with Tom rubbing my back with one hand and a pepperami in his other hand. He was obviously desperately hungry as he couldn't wait for my contraction to finish to eat it. So he asked, "Babe, can you pull my skin back?" You what, mate? Definitely an innuendo there. Luckily, by this point, my contraction had gone and I could see the comical side of his innocent question. The midwife then came back and got my cannula ready in my hand for the drip, which I knew I was having to have after my delivery to prevent hemorrhaging. This way, all they'd have to do was to just plug it in, and if I did lose too much blood, I'd be ready for a transfusion straight away. It was now 2 to 3 o'clock, so I spent that time in a deep, warm bath in one of the hospital rooms with Tom sat next to the bath. It was relaxing with fake candles on all round, so the atmosphere was calming. With contractions, it didn't help greatly with the pain, but helped take my mind off things slightly and try relax through them more. By 3, I was out of the bath and back in our room getting ready for my waters to be broken, but for now was just bouncing on the birthing ball. At 3:20, I was reacquainted with my old friend, Gas and Air. The contractions were now getting really intense and I needed something to take the edge off it so I could handle them better. The first time I had it again, I was sat. I went so lightheaded, I thought I was going to fall on my ass. It was decided that if I was to be using Gas and Air, when using it, I'd have to sit on the bed, not the ball. 3:30 came and it was time for another internal. The midwife had a feel about and said I was 6 centimetres, but it was stretching to 8 centimetres easily. They decided that they'd break my waters and push her down at the same time to make her engage and to minimise the risk of cord prolapse. In came Jo, the other midwife, to help. She pushed the baby down as my waters broke and it all went successfully. Tom even heard it go pop. They were shocked with how much water was coming out. Oh, it's coming. Oh, it's still coming. It's still coming. It's puddling around your bottom. I was absolutely drenched up to my back. Human waterfall strikes again. This was when the midwife noticed something in my waters. She tried to explain in a calm tone that the baby had done a poo inside of me and it was in my waters, that this meant there might be some complications when she's born and I'd have to be on a monitor and bed bound out so they could keep an eye on her to make sure she wasn't distressed at all. She explained how as soon as she was born she'd need to check her airways to see if she'd swallowed any of her poo. It's 4 o'clock. My back pain was increasing as well as my contractions. They were now coming 3 times in a 10-minute period, and the midwife explained we was waiting for them to get to 4 times every 10 minutes. This is when they class as my active labour starting, as my contractions were finally regular. I asked for a TENS machine and Tom was now in charge of pressing the booster buttons when I was having contractions. 4:30. The pain as each contraction came was crashing down on me like waves in a storm. Being bedbound, I just couldn't get comfortable. If I leant back, my back was in agony. If I leant forward, my stomach was in agony. Each time I tried to readjust my position, the monitors would just go batshit crazy and alarm because it would lose Lucy's heartbeat. After discussing it with Tom and the midwife, we came to the conclusion that I'd like an epidural. 4:45. Luckily, the anaesthetist was free and I was getting my drugs shortly. Watching him walk into the room, I swear my vagina even sighed in relief that I would be out of pain soon. I've never wanted to feel paralysed from waist down and have a huge needle rammed in my back as much in my life, until he opened his mouth and spoke. To put it nicely, he was the biggest anaesthetist asshole I've ever met in my life. His opening sentence was, "Why would you like one? Why do I want one?" Was he bloody joking? I think it was his way of trying to lighten the mood and make chit-chat, but last time I checked, I was in childbirth. When a melon-sized object is trying to mangle its way up your minge, you don't really feel like small talk. Thank God I was feeling so drained, so no words came out and I just stared at him in disgust. His next question was even stupider than the first. Well, why didn't you ask for one earlier? All right, mate. Because I wasn't in this much bloody pain earlier. I remember shouting in my head, whilst my face just threw him another look of disgust. By this point, I think he realised I wasn't in the mood for jokes, and I was in agony, wanting him to shut up and do his job and stab me in the back. But this guy didn't know when to quit, and before he left the room to get the needle, he asked, "Where are you from?" Tom looked him blankly and said, "Spalding." Why it mattered where we was from was totally irrelevant. He went on to say, "No, originally where are you from? Because your last name..." To which Tom responded bluntly again, "With Spalding." With that, he left the room to go fetch my epidural needle. I was then told to sit on the side of the bed with my legs down off the side, waiting for my epidural. My next contraction was so strong but different. All of my muscles was bearing down. This wasn't me bearing down. It was my body pushing. I told the midwife I've got the urge to push, so she said it's best to quickly have a look and check. She told me to lay on my back for the internal, but I physically couldn't lay still on my back from the pain. So as I laid on my side, she said she'd be able to check from this position. I was chuffing on my gas and air like there was no tomorrow. She told me to cock my leg so she could have a look. I'm sure I've had classy moments, but the pain I was in, I didn't think I'd be able to. But next thing I know, I've managed to hoik my leg up in the air so she can have a look. She then muttered these words. "Oh, there's the head. We're not having an epidural. We're having a baby." 4:58. The next contraction came, surging through me and my body. It was pushing down. It felt good to push down to try help with the pain and pressure that was consuming my body. I was breathing in the gas and air, so I felt so lightheaded and dizzy. The midwife was rushing around the room like a headless chicken, whilst I pushed trying to get her gloves on. With her gloves on, she was back between my legs and asked Tom to pull the emergency cord. Within seconds, two other midwives rushed into the room and asked what was happening. We was going to have an epidural, but now we're going to have a baby, and I've got nothing ready. She's going to be here in a few minutes. In the next few pushes, the head was here. Tom was holding the gas and air for me, and I remember pushing as hard as I can to try help the pressure down below. Whilst pushing, I could feel Pete and his cronies trying to make a reappearance also. But Tom was muttering words of encouragement. He was gripping my hands so tightly, saying, "Come on, babe, she's nearly here." The midwife was moving her left and right to try help her out, and in the next two pushes she was here. And the pressure was instantly relieved. At 5:04 p.m, Lucy Grace Halifax was born, weighing 9 pounds 2 ounces. Perfection. I remember looking at her, looking into her eyes and knowing that this was one of the best days of my life. My littlest lady was finally here, and we were now a family of four. I'm still winging parenthood, and it's now mission survival, with two girls born 14 months apart. Bring on our next adventures and hurdles as a family. My heart couldn't be any fuller of love than it is right now.
You're wrong.